to my boobs, yeah, to my dad. Don't see me, little bitch, still shaking ass.
And they shit free, nigga, show me cash. Fuck a broke boy, I been had a bag. I come in first place, I never been last. A bitch act stupid, bitch, get trash.
Don't read the comments, it will spoil the very satisfying ending. In 1999, a 20-year-old kid was obsessed with this 16-year-old girl, but she wasn't into him. Frustrated, he breaks into her house and demands that she dates him. When she refuses, he kills her. And then, he kills her 14-year-old sister too. Or so he thought. The 14-year-old survived and easily identified Paul Powell as the killer. Powell showed no remorse in court and even called the victim stupid. When he was sentenced to death, though, his attitude changed and he cried and begged for mercy. And unfortunately, mercy would come in the form of a legal loophole that switched his death sentence to a life sentence. Believing he was safe from the death penalty because of double jeopardy, he wrote this ridiculous letter to the prosecuting attorney, basically admitting to every single detail of the crime, kind of bragging about what he got away with. So the attorney just takes the letter, gives it to a judge, the judge looks at it and says, yep, there's new evidence here, orders a new trial, and immediately this dude is resentenced to death. And a few months later, this lowlife was executed.
These photos are not at all what they first appear to be, part 3. This appears to be a sightseeing photo, and it was taken in 2015 in Alabama on a hike. The girl in the picture is 18-year-old Jolie Callen, but it was taken by her ex-boyfriend, Lauren Bunner, right before he shot her twice and pushed her off the cliff. She texted her friend the night before, "If something happens to me, you'll know who I was with."
True crime in 60 seconds? Let's go. On April 22nd, 1964, Chester and Dora Franzak gave birth to a beautiful baby boy, Paul. The next morning, a nurse walks into the room asking if she could take Paul away for some testing. Dora hands him over, and then 20 minutes later, a real nurse walks in. This is when they realize that Paul is missing. This would become Chicago's largest manhunt in history at the time, involving over 175,000 postal workers and over 200 officers and FBI agents looking for Paul. Over 600 homes were searched, but sadly, nothing came of this. 2 years later, Chester and Dora were notified that an abandoned boy was found outside of a department store in New Jersey. And a year later, they claimed him as Paul, and they lived happily ever after. Or so we think. In 2012, Paul got his hands on some DNA testing kits and he found out that he was not biologically Paul Joseph Franzak. So where is the real Paul? We don't know.
This is why you shouldn't go for walks in Sweden. In 2008, a Swedish woman went out for an evening stroll with her dog, but never came back. Her husband went looking for her and found her dead next to a lake. The police immediately blamed her husband and sent him to jail. After a few months, the woman's forensic analysis report came back and it was clear the husband was innocent because there was all this hair and saliva on the woman's body that was not his. It turns out there is a very strange phenomenon that occurs in Sweden in the fall when all of the apples have fallen off of their trees. Those apples ferment, and then hordes of moose eat those apples, becoming drunk, and oftentimes very belligerent, like this drunk moose who got stuck in a tree. The hair and saliva of the killer belong to a drunk Swedish moose.
I want to bring light to a person whose death has not been talked about enough in the Black community and just in general. So, this is Kendrick Johnson, and he was murdered on January 11, 2013. His body was found rolled up in this mat at school, which is just completely disturbing. Detectives ruled this an accident, which is completely absurd, but I'll get into why they ruled it as an accident later. Detectives said that he went into the mat to retrieve his shoe and he got stuck and suffocated. His family did not believe this, so they did some digging on their own and hired somebody to actually check out his body. It turns out that he died from blunt force trauma. It is suspected that two white males that went to his school actually killed him because they were seen on video coming into the gymnasium after him. It was later found out that he was stuffed with newspaper too. He had no organs or intestines. I believe one of the boys' dad actually was a police officer, which is why this was so easy to cover up. His family sued, but that would never bring back Kendrick Johnson and that would never bring actual justice.
True crime in 60 seconds. Let's go. On February 14th, 1993, 5-year-old Sarah West and her little brother Seth were being babysat by their 16-year-old neighbor, Billy Schaefer. While watching a horror movie, Billy decided that he wanted to molest Sarah. So while Sarah was sleeping, he went ahead and molested her. He then stabbed her and mutilated her body. It was later found out that he also shot her in the head and he bit her on her thigh and breast. Billy then put Sarah's body into two trash bags and threw the trash bags over an embankment. Billy was arrested and openly confessed to this horrific crime. He pled guilty to aggravated murder and was sentenced to life with possibility of parole. On December 2nd, 2019, Billy did go in front of a judge and his request to go on parole was denied due to the horrific nature of this crime.
So I'm pretty sure every true crime fan has that one case that stays with you for a long time and that you can't let go. Mine's Johnny Gosch. He was kidnapped from his paperboy route on September 5th, 1982. Since then, there hasn't been a confirmed sighting of him. They think that they found pictures of him tied up, and I can't put those on TikTok. They're really graphic and really scary, but you can find them online. And his mother claims to have seen him again 15 years after his disappearance. He seemed scared. He told her he was involved in some really bad people, and he begged her not to tell anyone, but she had to because she was under oath. Johnny's case is very confusing and sad, and it's theorized that he was sold into a high-ranking trafficking ring. Unfortunately, due to his case's association with traffickers, the Pizzagate theorists really picked up on his case, and there's a lot of misinformation. But the confirmed evidence and information we do have is wild.
Imagine getting a life sentence at only 13 years old. Kids Who Kill, Part 5. This is Lionel Tate. He's the youngest person ever to receive a life sentence of imprisonment without the possibility of parole. When he was only 13 years old, he brutally murdered Tiffany Eunuch. While Tate's mom was babysitting Tiffany, he beat her to death. Tate told his mom that she hit her head on a table, but the autopsy revealed that he beat her so badly, they said it was basically like her going out the window of a third-story building and hitting the pavement. He stepped on her so hard that it lacerated her kidney. She had bruises from head to toe. But despite getting the life sentence with no parole when he was tried as an adult, 5 years later, it was overturned and he was released. But what we see with these child killers who get released is they most of the time ultimately end back up in prison, and that's exactly what happened. Tate performed an armed robbery on a pizza guy, ended up getting 30 years in prison, and that's where he is today.
Disturbing Serial Killer Quotes, Part 3. Joe Mathani. The words "I'm sorry" will never come out, for they would be a lie. I am more than willing to give up my life for what I have done, to have God judge me and send me to hell for eternity. Metheny killed up to 13 people, and he used their flesh for food he would make and sell at his burger stand.
All right, guys, I'm back with a story that is literally Casey Anthony 2.0. Let me tell you in 30 seconds why this chick is trying to pull the same shit Casey did. By the way, this is happening in real time as we speak. Megan Boswell is 18 years old and has a 15-month-old daughter named Evelyn. Baby Evelyn. Megan reported Evelyn missing in February, but hadn't seen her in 2 months since December. Sound familiar? She told police she last saw Evelyn when she dropped her off with the babysitter. I mean, she's not even trying to be original. She refused to give the babysitter's name to the police because she was scared she would take off with the kid. Then go get your daughter yourself, you stupid idiot. As the police start the search, Megan gives all sorts of conflicting information. Police ask her to take a polygraph. She refuses, saying she's pregnant and can't. Lie. Then she says her mom took her camping in Virginia. Another lie. She leads them on a wild goose chase and is finally arrested and charged with false reporting. A tip leads the police to a property owned by Megan's family. Evelyn's remains are found at the property, which is Megan's dad's property. More updates are rolling in. Stay tuned.
Marjorie McCall lived with her husband in Northern Ireland in the 1700s. She died of fever and was hastily buried to prevent the spread of it. She was buried with her wedding ring, which was known to be very valuable. Grave robbers found out about this and so dug up her coffin. They tried to remove the wedding ring from her, but they couldn't because her fingers had swollen considerably since death. They then decided to cut off her finger. As soon as blood was drawn, Marjorie came back to life. She wasn't actually dead, but was in a coma-like state. She then sat bolt upright and screamed. At home, her husband was sitting with their children and relatives. He then heard a knock at the door and said to his kids, "If your mother was still alive, I would swear that was her knock." Apparently, when he opened the door, he died of shock. He was then buried in the plot that Marjorie had recently vacated. She remarried and had several more kids. She eventually died for real, and her gravestone reads, "Lived once, buried twice."
I'm sure everybody wants to believe that these are some of the most unintelligent people on our planet. But the reality is, that's not always true. Before Ted Kaczynski was known as the Unabomber and terrorized the United States for 18 years, he was an academically gifted child who actually got into Harvard at the age of 16. During his time at Harvard, he was subjected to intense psychological testing that is actually very disturbing and 100% illegal now. He later became a professor at Berkeley, which is where things started going south. He believed that humanity was becoming immoral due to the rise of technology, and went completely off the grid for 18 years, living in an isolated cabin in the woods where he manufactured and mailed bombs across the United States.
How do female serial killers differ from male serial killers? Some common trends that I found are that female serial killers are less likely to be as brutal as male serial killers. In other words, they're less likely to mutilate or dismember their victims. Furthermore, torture seems to be less likely amongst female serial killers, as there seems to be some type of favoritism towards poison as their preferred method of murder. Finally, female serial killers are much less likely to partake in stalking their victims as opposed to their male counterparts.
Speaking of police shenanigans, this is Terrence Williams, and in 2004 he was pulled over in Naples, Florida by Deputy Steve Calkins for driving without a license. Deputy Calkins called in a dispatch using exaggerated black dialect and took Terrence away in the back of his police cruiser. When Terrence's family reported him missing, Deputy Calkins said he didn't remember anything. After witnesses report that they watched Deputy Calkins put Terrence in the back of a police car, Deputy Calkins all of a sudden says that he remembers taking him to the Circle K for his job. Terrence didn't work at the Circle K, he worked at Pizza Hut. Video footage at Circle K proves none of this is true, and Terrence Williams has never been seen since. Come to find out, a similar incident happened with Deputy Calkins 3 months prior. This is Felipe Santos, who got in a fender bender on the way to work. Deputy Calkins arrived at the scene and took Felipe away in a patrol car. When his brothers came to bail him out the next day, the deputy claims that he didn't take Felipe to jail. He instead took him to, guess where? The Circle K. Video surveillance shows that this isn't true either, and Felipe has never been heard from since, like for part two.
Father, hear me, help me, join me, won't you sing along? Twice. And we're gonna be spiteful. Yes, spiteful.
Remember those TikTokers that found a body in that suitcase following using the app Randonautica? Well, there is a case update. If you aren't too familiar with the case, basically a couple of TikTokers were using the app Randonautica, which takes you to random locations. It took them to a location in which they found a suitcase. Upon opening the suitcase, they realized they'd stumbled across something much more sinister, and it was all caught in a TikTok video. So the update. Initially, it was thought to just be one body in the suitcase. However, upon further investigation, it was discovered there were actually two. These were the bodies of the two people pictured above, 27-year-old Austin Cashwenner and 35-year-old Jessica Lewis. They had both been shot in the head and dismembered before being put in the suitcase. No suspects have been identified as of yet, so the family of the victims have put together a $10,000 cash reward for information leading to the apprehension of the murderer. Please be sure to like, comment, and share, and subscribe to my YouTube.